Hello, I got my hands on the inverter from the new 5th generation Prius. Today we're going to tear it down, take a close look at its internal structure, and see what's changed compared to the 4th generation model. After taking it apart, my initial impression is that the control circuit board and the 12-volt output DC-DC converter have been optimized quite a bit. Let's take a look at the exterior. First, this is the top side. There is a label here. This is the model number. It says Toyota and Denso, made in Japan. This is the inverter removed from the 5th generation Prius ZVW60. The 5th generation Prius comes in 3 different trim levels. Depending on the trim, the engine displacement changes, and the motor output also varies. This inverter was removed from ZVW60. Let's have a look at this thick wiring harness. There. The same amount of voltage as the battery voltage is applied to this harness. There is another socket where the harness can be plugged in. Judging by the size of the sockets, I'm guessing this one is the one that connects directly to the battery. By the way, you can open the harness like this and see the internal structure. It has a fuse inside. The fuse is rated at 450 volts and 60 amps. There's no way the main battery current is only 60 amps, so this harness is probably for supplying the battery voltage to other systems in the car. Let's have a look at another side of the inverter. This is a 12-volt output terminal to be used in the car. It steps down the battery voltage to supply a 12-volt output. The cable connected here is quite thick and robust. This cable needs to be thick because it carries a current of around 10 to 100 amps. Later, I will thoroughly check the configuration of this power conversion circuit that can handle such high currents. Let's take a look at the terminals next to it. These are the terminals that connect to the motor. A cable is supposed to be connected here, but it's removed. There are engravings that say 1V, 1U, 1W, 2V, 2U, and 2W. The Toyota hybrid system is equipped with 2 3-phase motors. Therefore, there are a total of 6 terminals. There is another terminal at the bottom. This is the DC terminal. And finally, let's have a look at this side. These are the inlet and outlet for the coolant. There is a pipe attached, but it can be removed. You can easily check the coolant channels by removing the plate on the bottom. Here it is. It can be removed quite easily. I think the coolant is probably fed from the bottom to prevent air from getting into the channels. From here, the coolant circulates around this side. Then it goes up through this resin pipe and flows further inside before exiting here. I'm guessing that is how the coolant flows. We'll roughly take a look at the internal structure. The control circuit board, inverter module, inductor, DC-DC converter at 12 volts, and the coolant channels at the bottom. This is the latest 5th generation Prius. The structure of the power control unit is a bit different between the 4th and 5th generation models. The main difference is the position of the coolant channels. These are the side views of the power control unit. The top part is the top plate and the bottom is the bottom plate. In the 4th generation model, the coolant channels are positioned right in the middle, running between the inductor and the 12-volt DC-DC converter. In the 5th generation though, the coolant channels are at the bottom, cooling both the inductor and the DC-DC converter. That's the main difference. Now, let's take a look inside. I'll remove the top lid. Now you can see a green control board. This area with the connector is mostly the power circuit. I'll show you later, but there are microcontrollers mounted on the backside. On the left side, there is a gate driver circuit used for the traction inverter. There are solder pads here. These are the control terminals of the power cards for the inverter or converter. In the 4th generation Prius, the power cards were connected through contact sockets. In the 5th generation, the connection method changed to soldering. With soldering, there's always a concern about potential cracks from long-term vibration, but I'm pretty sure Toyota has already dealt with that. Also, I'm guessing it's a bit cheaper than using sockets. When assembling, you need to insert the power card leads into the through holes. Aligning the boards for this looks a bit trickier than on the 4th gen design. The power supply for the gate driver circuit is a floating power supply. These are the transformers for the floating power supply. There are 4 of them. It's acceptable to share a common ground on the negative arm side of the inverter circuit, so the design adopts that configuration. The reference potential on the negative arm side is the same. On the other hand, on the positive arm side, all reference potentials between the gate and source or gate and emitter need to be isolated, which is why it's designed that way. If you take a close look at the copper foil on this PCB, you'll notice that the positive arm side has roughly 4 times the insulation distance. Let's remove this circuit board and take a look at the backside as well. By the way, I removed all the solder from this part because there were quite a number of power card leads inserted. The backside looks like this. It mainly consists of microcontrollers and a gate driver circuit. By the way, if you look at the front side, in addition to the power card area, there are several soldering pads. On the backside, there are resin sockets that guide the leads. The microcontrollers on this board are Renesas R7F7012-82, and there are 2 of the same kind. As I mentioned earlier, the Toyota hybrid system has 2 electric motors, so it seems that each motor requires its own microcontroller. There is a custom IC made by Denso below the microcontrollers. I can't tell what kind of operation this one performs, but since it is connected to the connector, it might be exchanging signals with the external devices. Next, let's take a look at the gate driver circuit here. What you see lined up are custom gate driver ICs made by Denso. In the 4th generation Prius, separate ICs were used for signal isolation and gate driving. In the fifth generation, there aren't any external insulation components like photocouplers, so I think the insulation is built into these custom ICs. There are different ways to achieve signal insulation like optocoupling or capacitive coupling, but it's unclear which method is used in these ICs. Let's take the inverter apart a bit further. By the way, this is what it looks like when the control circuit is mounted. I pulled it out like this. And here you can see the heat exchanger for cooling and the power cards inserted in it. We'll take a closer look at it later. The inside looks like this. It has quite a roomy design. There is still plenty of space here that is about the size of a fist. Let's remove this module and take a look at the overall configuration. First, what you see on the left side is the inductor. It's used to boost the battery voltage. And on the right side of the screen is the 12-volt output DC-DC converter. It steps down the traction battery voltage to 12 volts. This is the bottom area that houses the circuit board. And if you look at the backside, there are coolant channels that we saw earlier. This is the diagram of the main circuit. The right side of the whiteboard shows the main circuit of the inverter, and the left side of the whiteboard shows the main circuit of the bidirectional converter. Since there are two motors, two inverters are necessary, one for each. So this is the bidirectional converter. It has 160 microfarad and 530 microfarad film capacitors and a DC inductor. That's the configuration of the main circuit. Now let's take a look at the actual inverter. First, we will roughly look at the connections of the components. Let's rotate it and take a look all the way around. First, this is the main circuit section of the inverter. The power semiconductor packages used in this Prius inverter are double-sided cooled. These power cards are denso products. You can take this module off like this. And underneath it, these parts were hiding. This is a laminated bus bar and this is an inductor. They are connected like this. The positive and negative terminals of the traction battery connect to these two points. The voltage flows through the laminated bus bar, and only the positive terminal is connected to the inductor. The current then passes through the inductor and comes out from this positive terminal here. From there, it goes to the module we removed earlier through this terminal. After passing through the inductor, it goes to this bus bar. And then the voltage is boosted by the power cards through switching. This is the close look of the laminated bus bar. The leads of the power cards are welded to the copper bus bar by some method. Let's take a closer look at this module. Let's start with this long and black component. It's a film capacitor made by Panasonic, made in Japan. Panasonic has been supplying the film capacitors used in Prius inverters for a long time. The third, fourth, and now fifth generation models all use Panasonic film capacitors. Check out this water-cooled cooler. By alternating the power cards and coolers, it efficiently dissipates the heat generated by the power cards. By the way, these power cards are the two-in-one type. I previously made a video explaining power cards, so check out the link in the description. Actually, the third generation Prius didn't use power cards. Instead, it used a large power module. Starting with the fourth generation Prius, power cards were introduced. And the fifth generation Prius, which we're disassembling right now, also uses power cards. This is a water-cooled heat sink for cooling the power card. You can remove it like this. It comes out easily. There are insulators attached to both sides of the power cards, and it looks like they are made of ceramic. Thermal conductive grease is applied to both sides. And the power cards have bare copper cores. The cores on the backside are also exposed. This structure is designed to efficiently cool the power semiconductors inside the power cards. I also disassembled the water-cooled heat sink for cooling the power cards. It has a three-layer structure. This is the outer layer, the middle layer, and the inner layer. Each layer of the heat sink is equipped with fins to efficiently cool the power cards. In the middle layer in particular, fins are installed on both sides. The cooling efficiency appears to be extremely high. The power control unit of the fifth generation Prius that I'm disassembling uses a total of 8 power cards. 2 are used in the bidirectional converter that boost the battery voltage. And because the Toyota hybrid system uses 2 electric motors, each of the 2 inverters contains 3 power cards. I noticed something. When I took apart the fourth generation Prius, it used 7 power cards. But this fifth generation Prius has 8. The fourth generation Prius uses only 1 power card in its bidirectional converter, but the fifth generation Prius uses 2. Perhaps because the motor output has increased, they've raised the power that the bidirectional converter can handle. Now, we will compare the motor outputs of the fourth and fifth generation Prius. The fourth generation Prius hybrid model uses a 1NM synchronous electric motor, which delivers 53 kilowatts of power and 163 newton meters of torque. The fifth generation Prius uses a 1VM synchronous electric motor. The maximum output varies by model. The U trim reaches 70 kilowatts and 185 newton meters. The Z and G trims go up to 83 kilowatts and 206 newton meters. And the plug-in hybrid model delivers 120 kilowatts and 208 newton meters. The inverter I disassembled today came from the ZVW60 model. I'm not sure whether the power control units vary by trim or are standardized. But it's possible that the bidirectional converter uses 2 power cards in parallel to handle the increased motor output and allow more current to flow to the bidirectional converter. And finally, let's take a look at the 12-volt DC-DC converter. This is what the 12-volt output DC-DC converter looks like. This is the voltage input section, and this is the output section. In the input section, a laminated bus bar, which has been mentioned several times already, is connected. The battery is directly connected to this bus bar. This section of the circuit steps the battery's high voltage down to a low 12 volts. By the way, this component next to the circuit is an inductor, which has been mentioned several times. The windings on this inductor are exposed, and it probably generates a fair amount of heat. That heat is carried away through this thermal conductive sheet. This DC-DC converter uses several magnetic components. These are ferrite cores, and they're held in place with leaf springs. Leaf springs are likely used because torque control is simple. Tightening the screws is enough to get the required clamping force. I removed the circuit to have a closer look, front side, and here is the back side. In order to dissipate heat from the board to the aluminum case, thermal conductive sheets are everywhere. They are applied to all areas that generate heat. On the front side, many power semiconductors are installed. Directly on the opposite side, where they generate heat, thermal conductive sheets are attached. As I said earlier, this ferrite core was secured with a leaf spring. Under the ferrite core, a film for adjusting inductance was attached. The film was attached here as well. Only this inductor core had thermal conductive grease applied on the backside. My guess is that this inductor either generates a lot of heat, or the surrounding components run so hot that the core needs the grease to help dissipate it. This 12-volt output DC-DC converter is built on a single printed circuit board. All of its power semiconductor components are surface-mounted devices. Up until the 4th generation Prius, the converter was built on two circuit boards and used through whole discrete power semiconductors. This 5th generation converter has a significantly more optimized structure. Rather than just an optimization, I think it's almost an entirely new design. This circuit board is made by Toyota Industries Corporation. Toyota Industries products are used in various parts of vehicles. This is a 100-volt, 1,500-watt inverter offered as an option for hybrid vehicles. This one is also made by Toyota Industries Corporation. This is the configuration of the main circuit. It's an active clamp forward converter, and the secondary side uses synchronous rectification. The power semiconductors are used in parallel pairs, likely because this circuit has to handle a fairly large current. The layout of the power semiconductors is pretty impressive. These are all N-channel MOSFETs, and as you can see, their drain tabs are soldered down. If you flip it over, you can see that they are soldered onto the copper busbar. Getting this all put together must have been a real challenge. I'm guessing the busbar was soldered on this side first, likely by reflow or wave soldering. Then the power semiconductors were mounted on this side afterward. Since the busbar has such a large thermal mass, I imagine it was pretty challenging to determine the right soldering conditions for it. On top of that, this soldering process is used on components where heat dissipation is absolutely critical. Any implementation defects could make the parts really fragile and significantly increase the failure rate. It's impressive how they managed to pull off such a difficult soldering job here. I measured the thickness of the busbars. This busbar is 1.5 millimeters thick, while the others are about 1 millimeter. Same on the backside, these are all 1 millimeter thick. The copper busbars on which the power semiconductors are mounted vary in thickness depending on the location. The parts of the busbar soldered to the board are 1 millimeter thick. But where the power semiconductors are mounted, the board structure adds thickness, bringing the total to about 2.5 millimeters. Let me explain the circuit briefly. The battery voltage comes in from here. It's then smoothed by the inductors, capacitors, and so on. This is the switch on the primary side of the forward converter, and this is the switch for the clamp circuit. Let's flip it over. This is the primary side winding. They're using a single copper wire for the primary winding. You could use a PCB winding, but in this case, the current capacity probably wouldn't be enough. That's my guess. This soldering job on the winding looks pretty tricky. I can't really tell whether it was done by hand or by a machine. It's not clear from the looks. And here we have a copper busbar, which is part of the secondary circuit. They're using busbars on both the front and back, making extensive use of copper throughout the design. The secondary side switch of the forward converter uses Renesas N-channel MOSFETs. Two MOSFETs, each rated for 250 amps, are mounted in parallel. On the 4th gen Prius, the secondary switch used diodes. The 5th gen, however, seems to use synchronous rectification with N-channel MOSFETs. With diodes, there's a forward voltage drop, which tends to increase power losses. So I think in the 5th generation, they were able to significantly reduce heat generation by using synchronous rectification with MOSFETs. About the reason why so many busbars are used, the secondary side circuit carries currents ranging from tens to several hundred amps. So the copper foil on the PCB alone isn't enough to handle it. That's why these copper busbars are soldered onto the board. By the way, in the 4th generation model, a separate board was used for the secondary circuit of the forward converter. This one also uses a thick copper circuit board. In the 5th generation, they switched to using just a single circuit board, which I think is a great improvement. So I disassembled the power control unit of the 5th generation Prius. From what I saw inside, I'd say about 50% of the components have changed compared to the 4th generation. By optimizing and redesigning the overall structure and the internal circuits, quite a bit of extra space was created. There's still enough room inside that I can fit my fist in. Especially the 12-volt output DC-DC converter made by Toyota Industries, the last part I disassembled, I can honestly say it's completely different now. Optimization with new circuit designs or structural changes must have been extremely challenging. My honest impression is that I can't believe they managed to take it this far. I'm really impressed. Thank you for watching.